A very warm welcome to Choral Evensong at the University Church. If you're sitting in the nave and you would like to join us here in the chancel, you'd be very welcome to do so. An order of service gives details about everything that will happen in the course of the service. There's just one slight change, and that is that the Old Testament lesson will come from the book of Proverbs rather than the book of Nehemiah as advertised. It's a great joy and delight to welcome Dr. Celia Dean Drummond, who's the director of the Laudate Si Institute, as our preacher this evening. We now sit for the psalm.
The first lesson is written in the book of Proverbs, the 8th chapter. The Lord created me at the beginning of his work, the first of his acts of long ago. Ages ago I was set up, at the first, before the beginning of the earth. When there were no depths, I was brought forth, when there were no springs abounding with water. Before the mountains had been shaped, before the hills, I was brought forth. When he had not yet made earth and fields, or the world's first bits of soil. When he established the heavens, I was there. When he drew a circle on the face of the deep. When he made firm the skies above. When he established the fountains of the deep. When he assigned to the sea its limit, so that the waters might not transgress his command. When he marked out the foundations of the earth, then I was beside him like a master worker. And I was daily his delight, rejoicing before him always, rejoicing in his inhabited world and delighting in the human race. Here endeth the first lesson.
The second lesson is written in the Gospel of John, the 16th chapter. These things have I spoken unto you, that ye should not be offended. They shall put you out of the synagogues. Yea, the time cometh, that whosoever killeth you will think that he doeth God's service. And these things will they do unto you, because they have not known the Father nor me. But these things have I told you, that when the time shall come, ye may remember that I told you of them. And these things I said not unto you at the beginning, because I was with you. But now I go my way to him that sent me. And none of you asketh me, whither goest thou? But because I have said these things unto you, sorrow hath filled your heart. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you. And when he is come, he will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. Of sin, because they believe not on me. Of righteousness, because I go to my Father, and ye see me no more. Of judgment, because the prince of this world is judged. I have yet many things to say unto you, but ye cannot bear them now. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. Here endeth the second lesson.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
May the words I speak this day reflect something of the mystery of your word, O Lord, our strength and redeemer. Amen. Just a few weeks ago, the Nobel Prize for Medicine and Physiology was given to Svante Paabo for the coding work that he did on ancient DNA, working on our ancestors 2,000 or 3,000 years old, the Neanderthals and the Denisovans. His remarkable achievement shows not just that these ancient ancestors are the ancestors of all of us, but something of the mystery of the discoveries about what it means to be human. And new discoveries are being made every day by scientists that we are celebrating this week at the Science Festival. The ancient wisdom writers, too, also were carefully observing the natural world around them. The Proverbs Hymn to Wisdom talked about the gift of creation with wonder and delight. But wisdom was created first, accompanying God in the creative world that God has made, in all its diversity, intricate beauty, and astonishing variety. That same variety that the scientists are still discovering today. And when I was a scientist some years ago, I worked on a giant algal cell about 2 or 3 centimeters long that was a single cell and was visible to the naked eye, from which you could discover the movement of molecules across the membranes. I never ceased to be amazed at the wonder of these single cells. The Proverbs reading itself talks about the primordial unfolding of the elements of the world in which we live, rather like an ancient story of the Big Bang. But the verse 30, which speaks of wisdom itself, is ambiguous. Does it mean one brought up with him, that is, with God, or a little child, or, in the reading that we heard today, a master craftsperson? I like the one about the child the best. It speaks of the delight of wisdom working alongside God, and God delights in the work of wisdom as well. It's the exuberance of the young. We recently acquired a young puppy, a Red Fox Labrador, who's now 14 weeks old. She's exuberant and she loves people, rather like the wisdom who loves to be with the sons of humans. But that exuberance is also part of the delight of God. But wisdom is ambiguous. Is it passive and with play and delight like a little child, or is it active in creating? There's something of that dilemma in scientists as they work and move in their own science writing. Even scientists like Richard Dawkins speaks of the wonder of the natural world around him, although he doesn't acknowledge the God from whom that wonder comes. Norman Havel, in his work with the Wisdom School in the Hebrew Bible, talks about the ancient writers as the first scientists. And wisdom itself, he describes in a number of different ways in the wisdom texts. Wisdom is a force of nature, the cosmic coding, the primal blueprint, the ecological impulse, but also a profound mystery. But at the same time, wisdom is a purely natural phenomenon. And in the wisdom text of Proverbs 8, it's the primal beginning that we're thinking about that's also so fundamental to the way we think about the scientific world around us. Norman Havel also translates 8, verse 22, as Yahweh acquired me first, his way before his works. It's a primal way, or doeh, acquired, or kana in Hebrew. That idea of acquiring is interesting because other translations, the one that we heard today, spoke about wisdom being created. But this suggests that God somehow acquired wisdom. And if you think about it, that idea of God acquiring wisdom is an astonishing thought. The King James Bible speaks about wisdom being possessed by God, which is actually closer to the latest Hebrew scholars' understanding of what wisdom is about. But if God acquired wisdom, then God is also the first sage or the first scientist. God is like the first scientist coming into the play of the world. And what about 8:30, which speaks of the ambiguity of play and crafting? Again, that is also the play of science practice. Science seeks to imitate God through contemplation, but also through creativity, which is a dim echo of the creativity of God as God unfolds the created world. But those discoveries have their limits, and those limits have been set in place by the wisdom text that we heard tonight. Perhaps, though, that even that wisdom is somehow filtering through the world around us. So even those who have no faith, or even dimly awareness of faith, have some kind of consciousness that there's some other kind of spirituality out there. Maybe that is wisdom at work in the hearts and minds of those who do not yet know. Colossians 1:15-20 speaks of Christ being identified with wisdom in the wisdom of Proverbs. But now Christ is panto creator, the creator of the world. Christ is also firstborn, but not just accompanying God in the way that wisdom accompanies God in Proverbs 8, but now creating the world as well. And this then leads John 16, which we heard this evening, for Christ to say where he discovered that source of wisdom coming from. That source of wisdom is also the Spirit of truth. So God works as Father, Son, and Spirit in the creation of the world. But that Spirit will guide you into all truth. So that means that scientists, in their work of going about their discoveries, are not just somehow imitating God as the first sage or scientist, but also, in some sense, being accompanied by the Spirit himself, leading to spiritual insights, yes, but also insights about the material world in which we live in. If we deny that the Spirit is also leading to insights about the world, we're somehow denying the fact of the incarnation, that Christ became part of the material world in which we live. Scientists who are Christians may be conscious of that guiding by the Spirit of truth, such as in the work of Tom McLeish, for example, who's written extensively on his work as scientist, but also as a committed Christian. But it's also found in those who lack belief as well, but they do not yet recognize that the Spirit of wisdom is there with them and the Spirit of truth. The truth also remains, even in the most secularized sciences that we can imagine, because naming the truth about the world is the commitment of every scientist who's doing their job properly. There are huge challenges facing our humanity today. Challenges of environmental degradation, challenges of escalating poverty, challenges of biodiversity loss, challenges of misinformation. And all these point to the need for the priority of truth. And all these point to the priority of the work of scientists in seeking and finding that wisdom and that truth. Now, we're not all going to be scientists. I've been a scientist some years ago. And there's still something of a scientist in me in some of the collaborations that we do with scientists. But not all of us are going to be scientists, but we can all look around us and observe the natural world we can all enter into that play of creation. We can look at that world with a poet's eye. And that's why I'm going to end my talk today with a short quotation from Gerald Manley Hopkins' poem, God's Grandeur, because he talked about the wonder of looking at the natural world around him. And he says this, "And for all this, nature is never spent. There lives the dearest freshness deep down things. And though the last lights off the black west went, O morning, at the brown brink eastward springs. Because the Holy Ghost over the bent world broods with warm breasts and our bright wings." Amen.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we thank you for the wonder of all creation, so we pray that our understanding of it may grow and be guided by your goodness. We give thanks for all those who study nature through the sciences, for all who probe the questions of our history, the structures and meaning of our existence through the humanities. Help us, we pray, to use their work rightly for the service rather than the destruction of others, and grant that in our searching for truth, we may discover more of you, for you are truth itself. Lord God, you have given human beings the intelligence to understand something of nature and the curiosity to investigate the structure of your creation. Guide us, we pray, in our seeking after truth, that our knowledge may be put to good purposes and our moral instincts may be sharpened and deepened by our ever greater comprehension of this world and our ever greater reverence for the wonder of humanity. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for the beauty of this natural world. We pray for a better relationship between humanity and the rest of your creation. For all those who work in agriculture, for those who work in conservation, and for all governments and those forming environmental policy, that they may be inspired by the responsibility you have laid on us to be stewards of your creation. In particular, we pray today for the work of the Laudato Si Institute at Campion Hall within the University of Oxford. O God, you fashioned us to live in harmony with the world you have made. Deepen our respect for the gift of your creation, that working with the earth in ways that are sustainable, we may provide enough to feed all the peoples of this planet, now and for generations to come, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We pray for the peace of the world, praying in particular for the situation in Ukraine. Lord our God, we pray for your gifts of stability and wisdom in a world that seems turbulent and fragile, and for a renewed commitment on the part of all our leaders to building the confidence, trust, and security that allow ordinary people to flourish. Eternal God, through whose mercy the whole created order is held in its place, and through whose spirit of unity creatures are brought to delight in togetherness and human community is made possible, send your Holy Spirit on the nations of this world, that putting aside pride, war, and greed, we may reach out to one another in friendship and nurture within our own societies those gifts of tolerance, understanding, and love that bring joy to life. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Finally, we pray for our own needs, for those who, for whom we are bound to pray, and for all who are in any kind of need. O Lord, support us all the day long of this troublous life, until the shades lengthen, the evening comes, the busy world is hushed, the fever of life is over, and our work is done. Then, Lord, in thy mercy, grant us a safe lodging, a holy rest, and peace at the last, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We say together, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with us all evermore. Amen. Peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and the love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen.